Hey everyone, this Blender tutorial is all about how to organize nodes in Blender. We will cover 8 ways to organize nodes, including node frames, node groups, reroutes, and more. Stay till the end to see a really great add-on that helps with this as well. I'm using the shader editor, but all of this will apply to geometry nodes. So let's go. The first way to clean up an unorganized node tree is to collapse nodes you don't need access to. We simply click the arrow at the top left of the node and it collapses down to this. We can expand it by again clicking the arrow. But the second method of organizing nodes might be more useful. Instead of collapsing the entire node, we can hide only the unused sockets. For example, here's this principled BSDF shader. The shader has a lot of input sockets, and we may only be using a few. Let's select the node and then use the shortcut Ctrl-H. It's hidden all of the unused values, but we can still see the labels and settings for any sockets that are in use. The node is smaller and tidier. Pressing Ctrl-H again will unhide the sockets. Tip 3 for organizing nodes in Blender is to give them custom labels and colors. When we have a node selected, we can hover in the editor and press N to open up the node editor sidebar, just like we do in the 3D viewport. Under the node tab in the sidebar, we have options including name, label, and color. The name is how the node's data is stored behind the scenes in Blender, but the label is what appears at the top of the node. With this, we can clearly label each node in our setup. If we check the color box, we get a color picker to choose a custom color for the background of the selected node. This can make important nodes stand out in the node tree. There's also a preset function where we can save a color we use often and then load that preset into another node. The fourth Blender tip for organizing nodes is using frames to visually group and keep the nodes together. Select the nodes we want in the frame and press Ctrl-J to keep a frame around them. The frame is this box that's appeared. When we move a node in the frame will resize dynamically to keep its borders around the included nodes. If we want to remove one or more nodes from the frame, select them and press Alt-P on the keyboard. To select the frame, we have to click on its edge. To delete a frame entirely, select the frame and press X on the keyboard. Just like with individual nodes, we can customize a frame. Press N on the keyboard to open up the sidebar. We can give the frame a label, which will appear centered at the top of the frame. We can check the color box to give the frame's background a color. Under Properties, we can change the size of the font for the label. This Shrink button is checked by default. What this does is make the frame automatically shrink to the smallest size necessary for the node. If we uncheck the box and move a node in the frame will get bigger. But when we move it back, the frame will not shrink. Seems like a box that I will probably never uncheck. Blender tip number 5 for organizing nodes is using node groups, and this is a big one. We can take an entire section of connected nodes and make them into a node group. A node group is like a custom node that does whatever the nodes inside the group does. There are some very powerful things we can do with these, so make sure you watch this entire section of the video. To create a node group, select a series of connected nodes and press Ctrl-G. It will look like some of the nodes disappeared. What's really happened, though, is that the node group has been created and we've been taken inside of the group. Node groups operate kind of like how objects operate, in that we press Tab to enter and exit the group, kind of like entering and exiting edit mode in the 3D viewport. This is inside the node, like being in edit mode. If we press Tab, we are taken back out to the main shader editor. We see that all the nodes we have selected are gone and have been replaced with this single node labeled Node Group. With it selected, we press Tab and are taken back into the group. We can edit and change what's inside the node group. We can add to it, and whatever the final result that's plugged into this group output node will be what is output from the group node. Notice a second socket on the output node. We can drag any other output from the group into this socket. We can do this many times, and new sockets will continue to appear below it. Now when we tab out, we see these are also accessible outputs to use from this node group. So a single group can create many different outputs. But let's say we had a setting inside of the node group that we wanted to be able to adjust without going into the group itself. We see there is no way to control any of the group settings from this node right now. Well, press Tab and go back inside. This group input node is very helpful. We see it has one gray output. We can connect this output node to any input socket inside of the group. Notice when I connected it to this input, a new output socket appeared on the group input node. We can keep connecting this input to different settings that we may want to change later. Now when we press Tab to exit the group, the chosen inputs are available in the group node. This allows us to create extremely customizable node groups that can do whatever we want. Also, when we are inside the node group and open the sidebar menu within, we have a tab for group. Here we can rename the input values and the output values for this node group. This could be useful in a large node group to more clearly explain what this specific setting adjusts. These custom node groups are often sold as shaders in places like Blender Market. If you make something cool, you can package your node group and sell it as a custom shader as well. But wait, there is one more relatively new and awesome feature with node groups. We can add them to the Blender asset browser and make them available for use in other Blender files. If you're already familiar with setting up the asset browser, great. If not, I have a video on how to do this that I will link to. To add this node group to the asset browser, we need to go into the outliner. Change this dropdown, which is normally on View Layer, to Blender File. This shows all of the data in this Blender file. Go down to the tab for node groups and expand it. Find the node group we want to add to the asset browser. Right-click and select Mark as Asset. The little asset browser icon appears next to it to show it has been marked as an asset. Now, if we have an asset browser editor open, we will see our node group in the browser. We can drag it into the shader editor, and oh my god, do you realize how much time this could save us in future projects? Again, there are a few things you have to learn about setting up the asset browser, and I do have a video on that. The next tool for organizing nodes in Blender is using the reroute node. These are really simple. Press Shift A to add a node. We can search for reroute or find the node under the layout group. The node is just this little dot, and we click to place it where we want. Like other nodes, we can drop it onto a node connection in order to add it between two already connected nodes. The reroute node is simply to clean up the connections, which are called noodles, that are between nodes. A reroute accepts only one single input, but then allows that input to be routed to many other nodes. So instead of this, we can have this. Here's a little trick with reroutes. Open the sidebar, and we can give reroutes labels, like we can with other nodes. We can place a loose reroute node in our scene and use it to place a note or instructions in the node editor. It looks like the current limit for the label is 64 characters. In Blender, the connections between nodes are called noodles, and how straight or curvy they are can be adjusted. Go to Edit, Preferences, choose Themes, find Node Editor, and scroll down to the bottom of the settings to find Noodle Curving. This setting can be adjusted from 0 to 10. 0 is no curving, and the noodles will be straight lines. The higher we go, the more curve the noodles will have. And yeah, that's about all I have on noodle curving. The final tip I have is more of a plug for an add-on that I have found useful. The add-on is called Node Preview. When it's installed, every node in the shader editor can display a preview thumbnail above it, showing exactly what the output of that node looks like. I found this incredibly helpful in visualizing segments of complicated node trees. It's a simple and pretty responsive add-on. It is a paid add-on, and I have an affiliate link in the description if you want to check it out. I've also created a page on my site to be used as a reference for all of these node organization tips. That's at brandonsdrawings.com. Subscribe for more straightforward Blender tutorials. Thank you, and stay creative.